Well, this is our fourth and final week of God of the Underdog. Have you enjoyed this series? Three of y'all have. That's awesome. What about the rest of y'all? Anybody else enjoyed this series? The goal of this series has been to help us to understand our identity of who we are in Christ. That even though we may not be able to do it on our own, with Christ we can do all things. And man, how many know a lot of times we think that our past disqualifies us? We think that our messes disqualify us, but God made a habit and still makes a habit of using those with the biggest messes to do what he wants to do. And so we've been looking at that. I hope it's been encouraging to you. It's been encouraging to me for sure. I haven't talked about this a lot from the platform, but this is going to be the last message that I ever, ever preach as a single man. Three weeks from yesterday, so 20 days from today, 19 days and a couple hours, but who's counting? I don't know. I'll be getting married, and listen, glory, come on, somebody. Come on. Listen, if you did not believe in miracles, like if you didn't believe the miracles existed, the fact that I was able to bamboozle this girl, as awesome as she is, into spending the rest of her life with me, unforced, hey, he is the God of miracles. Modern day miracle, I promise you. I promise you. But I need to focus. And get back to why we're all here this morning. Mark chapter 10 in your Bibles, if you would turn there, please. See, you just got to cut it off. You know, I could stand up here and talk all day. You just got to cut off. Mark chapter 10 in your Bibles, if you would turn there. While you're turning there, I'll kind of give you a brief synopsis of Mark chapter 10 and where we see in verse 46, Bartimaeus, known as blind Bartimaeus throughout the Christian world, throughout church. If you're not from church, you may have never heard of blind Bartimaeus, but we talk about him all the time because he was a man of faith. We talked about how he was blind faith, how he could not see, but he had the faith to see. But Bartimaeus was blind, and he was a beggar. And he was out begging one day when Jesus came walking by. And during this time period, people thought that if you had some kind of an ailment or some kind of a problem, that it was punishment, that God was punishing you for what you had done wrong. They also would think that God was punishing your family, that maybe your family had done something wrong. Can you imagine not only having to deal with being blind, but having to deal with people judging you because you're blind, even though you can't help it? Can you imagine this situation where Bartimaeus is looking to people for help? Have you ever looked to somebody for help, and instead of being helped, they looked down on you because you were in that situation in the first place? And so it says in Mark chapter 10 and verse 46, then they came to Jericho, and as Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Bartimaeus asked for mercy before he ever asked to be healed. Which also lets me know that Bartimaeus is kind of agreeing with these people. That maybe because of what he's done in his past, he is experiencing this problem. That because of his family's past, because of his mistakes, that he's experiencing this problem. So he says, have mercy on me. But verse 48, many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. Anybody ever gotten to that point where people told you to be quiet, but you needed Jesus so badly that you did not care what anybody else said, that you did not care what anybody else thought, that you didn't care what anybody else looked at you like? You had to have him. It says he shouted all the more. And in verse 49, Jesus stopped and said, call him. So they called to the blind man, cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you. And throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. What do you want me to do for you? Jesus asked. And the blind man said, Rabbi, I want to see. Now, obviously, he wanted to see because he's blind. Obviously, Jesus knew that he wanted to see. Obviously, Jesus knew because he's Jesus that the man wanted to be able to see. He's blind. But Jesus asked him, what do you want? Because he wants us to acknowledge our need for him. See, it does you no good to have a problem in your life and to act as if you don't have a problem. Thank you, babe. Give her a round of applause. But it does you no good. Woo, there it is. It does you no good to act as if you have no problems, as if everything is okay, instead of bringing it to God. So Jesus is there, and he's having a moment with Bartimaeus, and he says, what is it that you need? I know what it is, but I want you to acknowledge the need that you have in your life. Verse 42, it says, go, Jesus told him. Your faith has healed you. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. Your faith has healed you. Not your effort, not your talent. Some of y'all, not even your good looks. Wow. He said, your faith is what has healed you. We can all kind of relate to Bartimaeus to some degree. Maybe you've never been blind physically, but we've all had a moment in our lives where we had a moment of desperation. Where something in our life was not working the way that we wanted it to work. Has anybody ever experienced a moment where something was not functioning the way that you wanted it to function? And it can be upsetting and frustrating. You ever had a moment of darkness where it didn't seem like you saw any way out? Like you didn't think that you would ever get out of that situation. And not only are you experiencing darkness, but people are not only not helping, but they're hurting. They're making it more difficult for you to bear. A moment of darkness where your marriage is not going the way that you thought it would go when you signed up for it, and now you don't know how you're ever going to get through this thing because you're committed, but you don't know how it's ever going to get better. A moment where your children are not acting right. They're not living up to their potential, and it's frustrating because you want... It's a moment of darkness where you know what can be done, but you can't ever see it. And so Bartimaeus is frustrated here, but he cries out to God. And I know that he was desperate because it says that he shouted. Bartimaeus shouted. And then when they told him to be quiet, he shouted all the more. Because there's something about these moments of desperation. There's something about the moment where you say, I don't have the answer. My friend doesn't have the answer. My family doesn't have the answer. My job doesn't have the answer. Nobody has the answer. There's something about these moments where we become intentional in our faith. And we say we have to go to the only one who has the answer, which is Jesus. So for this fourth and final week of God of the Underdog, I want to talk to you on the subtitle, Blind Movement. Blind Movement, let's pray. God, I thank you again for today. God, I thank you that you have brought us into this place together. I pray that you would speak to us for these next few moments. I pray, Lord, that you would put me on like a coat and wear me, that you would use me to do what only you can do. God, I pray that you would touch my body, that you would heal anything going on. And I pray, Lord, that today that everybody will be able to take what you said and apply it to their lives, that we would not just leave having heard it, but that we would apply it to our lives. And I thank you for it in Jesus' name. And everybody said... Can you relate to this? Can anybody relate to this? Have you ever had somebody in your life that you encountered that was a bit of a health snob? Anybody ever met a health snob? Can I get a witness? They only eat healthy. They only eat vegan or, you know, organic or no processed foods and paleo diet, whatever that is. I don't even know. I just throw it out there because I've heard it before. Anybody ever had somebody like that? Listen, let me tell you something. I'm all for eating healthy, right? I try to do it as much as possible, but some days your boy just wants to eat, okay? And there's nothing wrong with being healthy, but if I want to eat a Krispy Kreme donut cheeseburger, I brought it back. Some of y'all remember. Krispy Kreme donut cheeseburger, 5 chocolate chip cookies, and 4 scoops of ice cream. That's all I ask. All I ask is that you show me the same grace and the same mercy and the same love that I show you when you're eating your trees, you know, like when you're out eating leaves and stuff. That's all I ask. Can I get an amen? Anybody? See, and here's why I'm so passionate about this. Sometimes your boy just wants to eat. And I'm so passionate about it because a couple years ago, I went to a business meeting. And there was a guy there and everything was cool. I've never met him in my life. He's a stranger. And we sit down, we're talking business, we're talking life. Comes time to order. The waiter asked me what I wanted. Now, I had had a bad week. I'm going to throw that out there. I'd had a bad week. I'm eating my feelings, okay? And so I told him, listen, I want a double bacon cheeseburger. I want extra bacon. I want extra cheese. I don't want any lettuce or tomato. I want extra crispy French fries. And I want a large cookies and cream milkshake. Like, you want that for your dessert? No, I want it now. I'll get to dessert later, okay? And so I take this order, and the guy I'm with is looking at me. Now, I've never felt so judged in my entire life. I mean, you would have thought like I had killed his cat, and which is not far out there. I might have. I don't know. But he's just looking at me with such judgment. Like, he just hates my guts. And so I'm like, everything okay? He doesn't even acknowledge I asked him a question. He looks at the waiter and he says, I'll take the kale salad with extra kale and no dressing. And then he looks back at me. Like this, he's like, I'll take the kale salad. You know, he's like just judging me as he's ordering. And then he looks at me and judges me after he orders. So I'm like, okay, there is a problem. I said, sir, is something wrong? And this man has the audacity to look me in the eyes and say, trying to bulk up? Now, I'm like, you know, keeping my Christian flow going here, right? So I kept my thoughts to myself, but I wanted to be like, are you a rabbit? You know, who eats a kale salad with no dressing? It's not even a salad. At that point, it's just leaves and whatever kale is, I don't even know. And he said, the stranger, he's a stranger. I never met him again. I don't really care about that. He looks at me. Listen, I've forgiven everybody in my life but this man, as you can tell. I'm working through it right now. But he looks at me and he says, well, you know, this is the thing. Are you sure you want to eat all that? Because it's just not very healthy. And God only gave you one body. And you should be mindful of what you put into. What? This man just brought God onto the table and what I want to eat. I mean, it's unbelievable the audacity that some people have. And I couldn't believe it. And you know, I wish that I could stand up here and that I could tell you, hey, I told the man, I'm going to eat this regardless of what you say. But I was a people pleaser. See, I was a people pleaser back in the day. I'm not a people pleaser now. I'm not a pushover anymore. But I was a people pleaser. Now I just worry about the audience of one. But then I was worried about everybody else. So I looked at the waiter and I said, I'll have what he's having. But I did want the salad dressing on my salad. So I'm like, I'll have what he's having. And the waiter, he brings out this food. And up to this point, I have never eaten kale in my life. Furthermore, I have still never eaten kale in my life. Furthermore, I will never eat kale in my life. I won't do it. But that created another problem. That was the icing on the cake, because healthy food is expensive. So I paid $15 for a salad I never had any intention of eating when I could have enjoyed a juicy double bacon cheeseburger, some crispy French fries, and a cookies and cream milkshake for $9.50. And I've relived this moment many times in my life, and let me tell you how it had gone differently. When he said, are you sure you want to eat that? It's not that healthy. I would have said, it's okay. I'm not ordering for you. I'm ordering for me. It wasn't even for him. It was for me, but I allowed what he thought of me to change what I wanted to do. Now, this is just a burger. But I cannot help but wonder how many times in our lives we have missed out on the good thing that God had for us because we were too worried about what everybody else had to say about it. I can't help but wonder how many times we've allowed the opinions of everybody else that doesn't even want us to be doing good to cause us to miss out on the best that God had for our lives. Because Bartimaeus is here in verse 48, and he's crying out to Jesus. He wants to be healed. He knows in his knower, he knows within himself that Jesus can do it. But everybody around him tells him to shut up. It says that they rebuked him, and they told him, be quiet. But he shouted all the more. First thing I want you to see this morning, it's not for them. It's not for them. Don't allow people to rob you of what God has for your life. Don't allow the opinions of everybody else to stop your pursuit of what Jesus has for your life. It's not for them. But Bartimaeus wasn't bothering anybody. He wasn't bothering anybody. He was just sitting there doing what everybody else was doing. He wanted the same thing that everybody else wanted. He wanted an experience with Jesus. But everybody around him is trying to tell him to be quiet. They're trying to silence him. They're trying to tell. Can you imagine this? When you're wanting to see God do something, and you're trying to get people closest to you to believe with you, but instead they try to tell you to be quiet. And in these moments where you're wanting God to do something, where you know God's wanting to do something, in these moments when people try to silence your cry, when they try to silence your faith, when they try to silence your hope, don't be discouraged. It's not for them. Here's the problem that a lot of us have. We expect everybody else to get excited about what God is going to do in our life. Some of us run our mouth too early. Some of us, when God speaks into our lives and we know that he's going to do something, we start telling everybody. And then they start raining on our parade, and so we back off of what God promised us. They didn't make the promise. They didn't tell you it was going to happen. And so we get to this point where we go tell people, and then we get our feelings hurt. What did you expect? You should never expect anybody to get as excited about your vision as you are. You should never expect it. But let me just say this. Be mindful of who you hang with. Be mindful of who you... Watch out for people who always want you to stay in the same place you're at. The people who are your friends and your buddy until you start going to another level. The people that are your friends until you start telling them what God told you. Until you start telling them where God's taking you. Be mindful of those people, because there's always three people in your life. Three types. This is not on your notes, but I highly encourage you to write this down. There are three types of people in your life. There are doubters, there are suppressors, and there are cheerleaders. Doubters, suppressors, cheerleaders. Write them down. The doubters are the ones who try to silence you because they don't think God can do it anyways. The doubters are the ones who have never seen God do anything great because they never believed God could do anything great. The doubters are the ones who don't want you to believe in God because they don't think that he can do it. And so they try to silence you. But here's the biggie, the suppressors. Suppressors are the biggest problem because they look most often like your friends. Suppressors are the ones who are okay with you being okay until you start going to another level. Suppressors are the ones who don't want you believing anything great for God because they don't have any initiative to go get it themselves. Suppressors are the ones who think that they serve a limited God. So if God is blessing you, it means they got the short end of the stick. Suppressors, they're the hardest to identify because they look like your friends. They do. They tell you, man, I want you to do good. I want you to make it. I'm here for you. I've got you. And you know what? Sometimes they're telling the truth. They want you to do well. They just never want you to do better than they do. That's why the suppressor is so hard to understand, because you don't even know until you get to that level. And once you start getting to that level, they start pulling you down, and you're trusting in them because they've always been there for you. So you think they're looking out for you. They're not looking out for you. If God told you to go get it, go get it. It doesn't matter what anybody says. But the suppressor, The suppressor's there for you until you start trying to elevate yourself. But then there's the cheerleaders, and these are the ones that we all need. The cheerleaders are the ones who have truly experienced Jesus. And you know they've experienced it because they want everybody around them to be a part of it. They want everybody. They see the potential in your life, and they're going to do everything that they can to team up with you and pull it out until you get what God promised you. That's the people you need. The cheerleaders are the ones who are closest to Jesus. They're closest to Jesus because for all this time, Jesus is coming and Bartimaeus is crying out, but everybody around Bartimaeus is telling him to be quiet. But then when Jesus gets there, as Jesus is getting a little closer, the people that have been around Jesus start getting closer to Bartimaeus. And so they tell Bartimaeus, they said in verse 49, cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you. They saw the potential. They saw what Jesus was wanting to do. They understood that what Jesus had done in their lives was not just for them, but it was for them to help spread to other people. But the next thing I want you to see this morning is that you're called, that you've been called. See, Jesus did not call Bartimaeus, or Jesus called Bartimaeus. The people did not call Bartimaeus. The people even that called out the cheerleaders, they said, Jesus, he called you. He called you. So don't worry about what everybody else has to say. Don't allow the opinions and the thoughts of other people to stop you from what God is wanting to do. Don't allow the opinions of other people, because what they said about you, what they do to you, it doesn't even matter. All that matters is that Jesus called you. Because so often we focus too much on what other people say that we miss out on what God said. Far too often we focus too much on the opinions of everybody else that we miss out on the calling that God had for our lives. But Jesus is the one who called him. And it doesn't matter. You got to get to, this is where you got to get to. This is where I've gotten to. This is where you got to get to. You got to get to where you say, it does not matter what anybody else says. It doesn't matter what anybody else does. If everybody in my life leaves me, it's okay, because my coworkers didn't call me. My family didn't call me. My friends didn't call me. God called me. And if God called me, that's all that matters. It doesn't matter what anybody else says. It doesn't matter how everybody else is treating you. If God called you, it's a done deal. God called you. God equipped you. God empowered you. But this is what I love the most in this story, is that Jesus calls him in front of everybody that told him to be quiet. He calls Bartimaeus. He didn't pull Bartimaeus to the side and say, come here, come here, come here, come here. I got something I got to tell you. He called for Bartimaeus in front of everybody that was rebuking him and telling him that he did not deserve it. Because here's what they didn't realize. Jesus does not show favor to those who deserve it. He shows favor to those who pursue it. And it was the pursuit of Bartimaeus that got Jesus' attention. Bartimaeus was so hungry to have what Jesus had for his life, he pursued him at all costs. No matter what people said, I'm sure he got kicked. I'm sure he got pushed. It didn't matter. He pursued Jesus, and it was his pursuit that got Jesus' attention and stopped Jesus in his tracks. All the while, Bartimaeus was still broken. Bartimaeus was still in his mess. He was blind. Jesus did not heal him and then call him. Jesus called him, and then he healed him. Bartimaeus was still in his mess. See, we think that we have to get it all looking nice and neat before we approach God. Religion's taught us that his goodness and his grace and his mercy and his love is only for those who prove themselves to be worthy. But here's what Jesus always did. He saw the best in people when they were at their worst. He saw the best in Bartimaeus, even though Bartimaeus was sitting there broken and blind in a beggar's cloak, not able to do anything else but beg, because that's all he was good for. And Jesus saw the best and Bartimaeus. He met people and their realities. He met people in their messes. He met people in their junk. He met Bartimaeus, and he loved Bartimaeus, and he believed in Bartimaeus, even though there was nothing lovable or admirable about him. He met Bartimaeus right where he was. And then watch what Bartimaeus does in verse 50. It says, throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. Now, this cloak that he was wearing was what's called a beggar's cloak. This was for people who, like I said, were good for nothing else but begging. It was actually a profession. People would hire you to sit there with a beggar's cloak on, take in the money, take it to them, and then they give you like a penny on the dollar. It's crazy, crazy what was going on. But Bartimaeus was just sitting there, and he was begging, and he was begging, and he was begging. But when he saw Jesus, he threw his cloak to the side. When people saw his beggar's cloak, they didn't have to ask him what he did. They didn't have to ask him anything about him. His beggar's cloak told them all they needed to know. It labeled him in a way that they knew everything about him. But when he saw Jesus, when Jesus called him, he threw it aside. This is huge. He threw his cloak aside. The next thing I got to get you to see this morning, you got to remove the label. You got to remove the label. He threw it aside before he was even healed. He threw the thing that tied him to his previous condition away before he ever was healed of his condition. Because by faith, he was removing the label that tied him to his previous situation. He was believing that God was going to do exactly what he said he would do, even before he ever saw it happen, even before he ever saw a change. Bartimaeus threw away his cloak. He said, I'm not going to be needing this anymore. That's faith. Where before you take the training wheels, or before you actually have some help, you just take the training wheels right off. You just know that you're going to make it, that God's going to do this thing. See, I believe that like when you're romancing, right? Like when you're like in them early stages. Okay, hello, somebody. When you're in them early stages, you know, and you got to give compliments. Like, you got to give them all throughout. But I'm saying, you know, you're always letting that special somebody know how you feel about them. Like, you know, you're beautiful. You look so nice today. You're the best thing that's ever happened to me. Outside of Jesus. Hey! You compliment them. You know, you tell them things. But I like doing that. I just like to, because I feel like if you love somebody and if you're thankful for what they mean to your life, you let them know they're appreciated, right? And so a couple days ago, Nicole and I were at the gym, and she was up and she was on the treadmill, and I was down lifting my 5-pound heavy weights in the weight area. And I looked up and I saw her, and I was like, man. I pulled out my phone. I said, looking good up there, Mrs. Barker. Oh, yeah. Now, she's not a barker yet, but I was speaking to the potential of what I believe that she's going to be in 20 days. See, some of you are speaking to your problem, but you need to speak to the potential. Some of you are allowing yourself to be labeled by your problem. But you don't need to label your problem. You need to start speaking to the potential. Some of you can't be healed because you're still wearing your old label. Furthermore, some of you have been healed, but you're still living in the past because you never got rid of the label that tied you there. Tell somebody, remove the label. Remove the label. Stop labeling yourself by where you are or where you've been, and start labeling yourself by where you know you're going to go. I may be sick, but I am healed. I may be dysfunctional, but I am functional. I may not have it all together, but I have it all together. I may be a mess, I may be an addict, but I am set free. Stop labeling yourself by where you are and start labeling yourself by where you're going. You've been called. I'm not staying where I'm at. I've been called. I'm being changed. It may not look great right now, but I'm going somewhere. God's sending me somewhere. He's taking me somewhere. Because Bartimaeus, he removes the label that tied him to his past. Of a player, of a hoe, too real on a Sunday morning, I don't know, I'm just going to throw it out there, take it or leave it. He removed the label that everybody had labeled him by. Divorcee, junk, no good, never going to make it, deadbeat. He removed the label that everybody else had put on him. And he came running to Jesus, and look at what Jesus said in verse number 52. He said, go. Your faith has healed you. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. The last thing I want you to see this morning is that you have to go blindly. Jesus told him to go, and then he healed him. It says he told him to go, and then he said, your faith has healed you. Because Jesus will always give you an instruction that is something that you wouldn't have been able to do in your previous condition right before he heals it. He couldn't have gone anywhere beforehand. He was blind. He was tied to his beggar's area. He wasn't allowed to leave that spot. But Jesus told him, he said, go. Because Jesus always has you do something that you couldn't have done before. He always gives you an instruction. See, a lot of us, we say things like this. Well, you know, once God heals my marriage, then I'll start doing some things for him. Once God restores my family, then I'll live for him. Once I get to my certain age that I need to be at, then I will live for him. Once my finances get back in order, then I'll start serving God. But God gives an instruction. Jesus said, Bartimaeus, I'm going to heal you, but first I got to give you an instruction of something that you need to do. You need to go. You need to go. See, God's not waiting on you to have it all figured out. He's not waiting on you to be perfect. He's not waiting on you to have it all. But you do have to be willing to go. Even if you have to go blindly. Even if you don't have it all figured out and you got to go trying to figure things out. Go. Just go, because God's called you. And if God called you, he called you in spite of who you were. He called you in spite of where you've been. He called you in spite of the names people have labeled you. He called you in spite of your past conditions. God called you, and he's calling you, and he's telling you to get up. To get up. Somebody in this place, get up and rejoice and to go into the thing that God has for your life. Would you stand with me, please? God, I thank you that you and what you've said about us is all that matters. God, I thank you that you've said that we're called. God, I thank you that you said that we're chosen. And God, I pray that you would help us to get up and to step into the fulfillment of what you have said about us. God, that we may not live our lives tied down to our previous labels, but that we may live our lives in the label that you have given us. God, I pray that you would just speak to each and every one of us this morning, as these next few moments that we're together. I pray, Lord, everybody, no looking around, but God, I pray that you would just speak to us, show us areas in our lives. God, I pray that you would show us people. I pray that you would show us the doubters. I pray that you would show us the suppressors. But God, I pray that you would show us the cheerleaders. The people who you've placed in our lives to get us where you're taking us. With every head bowed, every eye closed. And maybe you're here this morning and you'd say, you know what? My life hadn't been perfect. I'm not proud of where I come from. And if I'm being really real, I'm not totally proud of where I am today. But I know that God's called me, and I'm ready to step into that and to remove my past label and to step into who God's calling me. If that's you and you'd say, I need to step into what God has for me. I'm tired of waiting. I'm tired of standing by. I'm tired of allowing my past to hold me. I got to step into it. If you would just lift your hand right up and right back down. God, I'm stepping out today. God, I'm rejoicing and I'm stepping out today. Right up and right back down. And maybe you're here this morning and you'd say, you know, I've never been able to remove my past labels because I've never had a relationship with Jesus to take me to my new level. But today I want to give my life to the only one who can restore me, to the only one who can take me where I need to go, to the only one who knows what I am truly called to do. And today I want to commit my life, or maybe I want to recommit my life today. If you would, just slip your hand right up and right back down. Jesus, I need you in my life. Jesus, I cannot do it without you. Right back down. I want everyone in this room to